Okay, good morning and welcome to Bruegel and to our seminar today on central bank banking after the Great Recession. I have to say you're an extremely disciplined audience. At 10:46 everybody was sitting already, so I was very impressed. Perhaps it's because there's the central banking background here, so the discipline and timeliness is important. So welcome again, and it's good to discuss with you today. We have two panels today. One is on macroprudential policy and its relationship with the monetary policy, especially in the complex European framework. The second one is on after the crisis, the evolving role of central banks. And let me start by thanking Gregory Kleiss, our research fellow, for being the intellectual mastermind of today's seminar and having put together this great lineup and also the conceptual thinking on what we want to discuss. Now, I think the two topics are, of course, extremely interesting. Everybody nowadays thinks macroprudential policy or speaks about macroprudential policy, and actually many people believe it's the solution to all of our problems. Now, I will not reveal here what is my view at this stage, not to influence the debate, but certainly I would be very curious to learn what exactly is meant with macroprudential policy. Whether or not our speakers will think that we need more of it, also because monetary policy is doing at the moment quite a bit of things that are sort of unconventional, and there could be financial consequences, financial instability related to this. And the third point, of course, the difficult European framework. I mean, where do we stand? Who takes actually what kind of decisions? I mean, even for someone who follows the European institution setup on a professional basis, as I do, it is quite complicated to really understand who's responsible for what exactly in this entire framework. After the lunch, we will have a discussion on the evolving role of central banking after the crisis, and it seems to me that this is, of course, also an extremely central question, especially if we start from a belief that we live sort of in a 2% world. 2%, what is 2%? Let's say 1 to 1.5% real growth and 0 to 0.5% inflation. So perhaps it's a 1.5% world. We will see that in the next years. And a nominal rate, interest rate of around zero. Now, if that is the case, then the question is, what is central banking actually doing beyond, buying assets? Aren't we coming to a level where, beyond central banking, we actually need some sort of fiscal policy? And is that, the famous word of helicopter money? Is helicopter money not really, actually fiscal policy in the disguise of monetary policy? And is that what we should be talking about? And so I think that's just a question that I sort of push here to the panel. But I'm sure we will have many insights, because we have absolutely distinguished speakers today that I will not introduce. I think every chairman can introduce the speakers. But let me again welcome you and thank you for coming to today's event. Let me also say this event is on the record and it is being live streamed. Why is that? I mean, it's actually because nowadays it's easier for central bankers to speak when it's live streamed than before. I mean, I remember the times people didn't want to have any media, any live stream. Now everybody wants that because nobody should have any privileged access to information. So this is, the whole world is watching what we are discussing today. So without much further ado, Dirk, over to you. You chair the first session.
Interplay between macroprudential and monetary policy. Well, we thought the setup of the European system of central bank was quite complicated. you haven't seen anything yet if you move to macroprudential, and we will learn that this morning. And how important is macroprudential? Because we are now in a QA environment with low interest rates. And then there's an ideal ground for bubbles to arise. Many people don't see them yet, including myself. But if we look to history, for example, in the post-dot-com bubble, that was making the seeds for the asset price bubble afterwards. So to my mind, I think macroprudential is extremely important to do in advance. It works in advance, not during a crisis, because then we go to crisis management and we know what to do. And we have this single resolution burden, everything. But how can we prevent the next cycle going out of hand? And I think that's one of the major questions. Should we just build higher dikes, resilience of the system, or should we also try to tame the financial cycle? I think that's one big question. And everybody would find that extremely difficult. There are no clear instruments yet, but should we aim for that or not? The next question is, at which level? The financial cycle is clearly a country phenomenon, as we have seen with Ireland and Spain and other countries. But do we need the ECB for consistency in the euro area? And there are a lot of cross-border leakages. And then what kind of instruments? It's not clear at all which instruments work best. Asia has more experience because they had the Asian crisis. Whoever is first in a crisis has also an advantage, because then he will do the new policy first. So in Asia, there is some more experience. But let me now quickly move to my colleagues on the panel. And for two reasons, we really have an excellent lineup. At Bruegel, we like to work on strategic design. And in this case, we have the center, we have a major in-country, and a major out-country. So all sides of the European setup are in the panel. And secondly, they are all active central bankers. But in addition, they have a Ministry of Finance background or are very close to that. And I've also been at both institutions, Ministry of Finance and Central Bank. And at least what you learn at the Ministry of Finance, that almost everything is political. And certainly macroprudential is very political. And I will introduce the speakers. Ignacio Anceloni, the first one on my right to the left, now has become a supervisor, and he just taught me the first time in his life. After a strong career in central banking, the ECB and Banca d'Italia, but also been at the Italian Ministry of Finance. And the most important aspect is he's a fellow at large at Bruegel. So if you are a fellow here and then you go to an eminent position, then we make the people a fellow at large. So, secondly, Claudia Buch, deputy president at the Bundesbank. We know each other for a long time from academia and from the Advisory Scientific Committee of the European Systemic Risk Board, where we had many meetings over the last 4 years. Strong career in academia and distinguished career. Also cross-border banking. And I think for macroprudential, it's very important to have this cross-border perspective. And although Claudia has not been at the ministry, but extremely close, because we all know in Germany you have this council of experts who is advising the ministries. So at least you've been inside the buildings and advising the ministers. And finally, Cecilia Skingsley, thank you. Deputy Governor at the Risk Bank, worked also in the private sector, Swedbank, and also in the public sector, the Swedish Ministry of Finance. So welcome as well. And I think in this way, we really have all sides at the table. And we kick off with a 10 to 15 minute presentation. And then we open for questions from the floor. Ignacio, can we start with you?
Thank you very much, Dirk. And also thank you, Guntram, for the nice words of introduction and for inviting me here. It's great to be back at Bruegel, of which I'm a fellow at large, as you mentioned. I think this is an important topic, an important panel, and seeing it from the perspective of the ECB, SSM, I think it's even more important because the SSM has been established recently. It has macroprudential powers and responsibilities. It is located in the ECB. The ECB does monetary policy. The ECB hosts the European Systemic Risk Board, so there is a convergence of elements there that make this type of discussion particularly important. Now, having said that, I think that when it comes to macroprudential policies, let's face it, we've seen in the last several years lots of discussions, but we've seen much less in terms of meaningful and effective policy actions. So the question, why is that? I think that comes back to the complexity that you mentioned, Guntram, in your introduction, as also mentioned in the title of the panel. Macroprudential policy is complex, and those complexities are not yet fully resolved. I believe there are institutional complexities, and the reference to Europe highlights that, but there are also inherent, conceptual, analytical complexities that have to be resolved. So I will touch briefly on both of them before, if there is time, saying something on how we see the financial stability situation at present and the challenges for policy. Let me start with the inherent conceptual complexities or complications. Well, I think it boils down to the fact that macroprudential policy have some difficulties finding its own separate, well-identified place between microprudential supervision and monetary policy. Microprudential supervision aiming at making the banks safe and sound, which is an interesting semantics, meaning essentially stable and controlling risks. Doing that on a micro way, so for each individual banks, but that includes also the very large banks, the systemic ones. And so there it comes also the interaction with the real economy, the feedbacks, the interlinkages, the contagion, and all these things. And the modern conception of supervision after the crisis has to include that. So the micro supervisor cannot be ignorant or not focus and not consider, not encompass also these aspects in its actions. And then monetary policy, of course, to aim at price stability and to do, to the extent required and implied by the statute, also countercyclical policy. So the problem of macroprudential supervision distinguished from micro is essentially in the fact that it's difficult to distinguish the goal, as I already mentioned, so systemic stability, but that's also included in some way in the list of things that the micro supervisor has to look at. And also, it's very difficult, even more difficult, to distinguish the instruments, because we are really talking in both cases about capital requirements, capital surcharges, liquidity coverage requirements, other constraints on the balance sheets, like, for example, net stable funding requirements. Both the micro supervisor and the macro supervisor, perhaps with a slightly different perspective, but they are all focusing on and using the same set of instruments. So it's very hard, if you think of it, it's very hard to draw the borderline. So if we think of the classic, simple, frequently used Theil-Tinbergen classification, the static version of it, so the number of goals has to be the same as the number of instruments, some authors, including Dirk, I believe, in one of his publications, has proposed a tripartite classification, so microprudential, macroprudential, monetary policy, safety and soundness, financial stability, and price stability. An alternative conception, which I would think perhaps would be equally or more straightforward, would be to have two, to have a prudential policy in which the supervisor performs the function of a micro-supervisor, but at the same time takes into account the full picture, including the macroprudential one, aiming at financial stability. Financial stability means For the banks that have no systemic implication, it's relatively simple. But for those that have systemic implication, you have to consider all those repercussions and the contagion and the network interlinkages. And then monetary policy and the other macroprudential policies aiming at price stability and the rest. So that's an alternative conception that one can consider, which would imply a much closer connection, in my view appropriate, between the micro supervisor and the macroprudential supervisor. Now, in the middle of these complexities, I think there is a risk, or a possibility at least, that macroprudential policy be somewhat diverted and used for other purposes. Okay? And I think that we see this happening to some extent in the euro area, where national authorities, of course, no longer have at their disposal monetary policy at the national level and exchange rate policy. So there is a lack and there is a desire for levers at the national level. And so there is a possibility that macroprudential instruments, which are largely in the nature of credit policies, be used to correct at the national level monetary policy stance, which is set for the euro area as a whole, which may not always be fully appropriate for each individual country. Now, that may be good or bad, depending on the point of view. We leave it to the discussion. But I remember a little bit the old times. I'm sure other people of my generation, like Andre, also remember it, the 1970s and the 1980s, in which in some countries there was a monetary policy and a credit policy with constrained capital markets, and was an attempt to use the two to attain different goals within the same country. And I think that the experience of that policy setting was not always successful, to say the least. Let me move quickly to the institutional complexities. In Europe, so in Europe we have macroprudential instruments which are not in the European legislation. The loan-to-value ratio, the loan-to-income ratio, etc., those are not available to the European authorities, are only available to the national authorities. There is no shared competence for those, and there is, I think it's fair to say, there is no coordination. Then there are instruments which are in the European legislation, the countercyclical capital buffer, the GC buffer, the OC buffer, etc., and those are a shared competence between the national so-called delegated authorities, or the national authorities for the macroprudential policy, which has been set up following the CRD-CRR, and the ECB. The ECB can only top up. So it can only make the instruments decided by national authorities more restrictive, supposedly compensating for an inaction bias on the part of national authorities. In the ECB, we have the following things. We have the ESRB, which issues recommendations, not operational decisions, only recommendations, which has become, over time, I think, a very powerful source of analysis and also recommendation in certain fields, but particularly it has strengthened the analytical side quite a bit. It has a very powerful academic support. Then we have the supervisory board that has the right of initiative, so the right of initiating the process of activating the macroprudential instruments at the European level, but cannot decide because, of, as you know, the supervisory board can only submit prepared decision to the supervisory board. To the governing council, who is the final decision maker. Then we have the governing council, of course, that can also initiate the process, also has the power of initiative. But then in order to prepare the decision, has to go back to the supervisory board, prepares the decision, and then back to the governing council for the final decision. And then we have established a formation that to put the two together, in a sense, to have a broader discussion, which we call the Macroprudential Forum, which includes both the supervisory board and the governing council. It's a very large body that so far has been a source of interesting discussions, exchanges of views, but no no policy action. So it remains to be seen when Europe will decide to move in terms of activating macroprudential instruments in a picture that so far has seen only national authorities basically making decisions. That's also something that we can discuss. What I note is that in the United States, in which there are to some extent also complexities of institutional nature there because of the interagency competencies and the state and local versus federal decision framework, etc. There, they have recently conducted some studies and they have, I think, concluded that they are not going to move macroprudential instruments anytime soon. They consider it very interesting, very important topic for discussion, but further work is needed, and the U.S. are not ready now to use that instrument. Let me conclude by saying that in our publications and our analysis, now we see the financial stability situation in the euro area also complex by a number of factors. First of all, as well known and frequently discussed, the low level of interest rates, which generates a number of consequences. One is the risk-taking behavior, and we've discussed that many times, that to some extent indirectly also affects the insurance sectors. But more directly, the low level of interest rates and the low level of spreads affects the main component of the profitability of banks. So it weakens, particularly over time, in an incremental way, it weakens the banking sector. Then the non-performing loans problem, that's a heritage of the crisis, but of course it's still with us to a different degree. And that compounds with the low level of interest rates to produce a situation in which banks have a low profitability. And that situation is going to be there for a while and weakens, as I said, gradually the bank. So the risk I see in that context is a situation in which there may be specific issues in particular banks that one has to look at. And then there is a general fragility and there could be contagion phenomena there. And so, plus a number of institutional developments like the phasing in of BRRD, which is a new regulatory construct. It has a bailing in provision and all these things. So in this situation, I think there are some elements of fragility that one has to look at. And I believe, that's my concluding statement, that in this picture, the main burden for financial stability in the foreseeable future, the main burden will be on microprudential supervision to make sure that individual banking situations are well guarded sufficiently in advance to avoid that these contagion and risk processes can materialize.
Thank you very much, Ignacio, for this excellent introduction. And I think we already have quite a few nice points for discussion in the panel later on, the division between national credit policies and the center. But I first go to Claudia for the second presentation.
Yes, thank you very much. And I've also brought a short presentation, so maybe that can be uploaded. Yes, thank you very much. Yeah, so I guess we all had to, first of all, thank you for having us here, having me here. I guess we all had to decide what do we want to focus on. It's macroprudential policy, it's relationship with monetary policy and the complex European framework, and we have 10 to 15 minutes to talk about it. So I try to narrow it down a little bit, so if you can... So I think I can basically skip over this first slide, which is trying to summarize our definition of financial stability, which is one of the main reasons why this is such a complex policy issue, because it's hard to define what exactly financial stability is, how we can operationalize it. Ignacio already mentioned a couple of relevant issues. It's not only about direct linkages between financial institutions that can cause contagion, but it's also about indirect linkages, and we all know how difficult these are to quantify. So basically what we are after with macroprudential policy is the question, how can we contain a shock which is affecting a small set of institutions, or only one institution, from having an impact on the entire financial system and on the real economy. And so that's a task of macroprudential policy, of limiting this degree of financial contagion. Maybe just one side remark why there's also a sense, as Ignacio has mentioned, that there's not much action on the macroprudential policy front, is that a lot of people would say, well, we've done a lot in terms of increasing the capitalization, the requirements for capitalization of banks, and this is what we have done over the past years, and so this is basically, in that sense, the reform agenda is complete, and of course we know that we have to be alert, and that we may also need other policy instruments. We might have to modify the instruments that we already have. So why is it so difficult to implement macroprudential policies and to also get a good discussion about what we should be doing? It's the wrong direction. Okay. Well, this is also a bit what has already been mentioned. Macroprudential policy takes place under a high degree of uncertainty. So we don't really have the theoretical models that could guide us to an efficient policy making. We're still figuring out what are the data that we actually need for surveillance of the financial system, and we have to define appropriate targets and objectives of macroprudential policy. So taking all this uncertainty together, you might come to the conclusion, and this is also what you hear very often in policy discussions, why we should wait. We should do more analysis. We should ask the academics to do more theoretical modeling, and then have a good framework that we can use for our analysis. So this inaction bias, I think, is inherent in most of the discussions we have on macroprudential policies. And there's also another risk, namely the risk that if we act too early or if we act prematurely, we might be using macroprudential policies or if we don't have an adequate framework, we might be using macroprudential policies for other policy purposes. And this is also something that has been mentioned before. So how can we deal with this uncertainty and with the risk that it entails? Well, the point I want to make here is that we really need a clear strategy for a policy evaluation, for ex-ante impact assessment, and also for asking ourselves, once we've implemented certain macroprudential policy instruments, having a clear schedule of how to check whether what we have done is actually reaching its objectives and its targets. I think this is one way, to put it a little bit differently, to narrow down the range of uncertainty that we inevitably have, while not having this uncertainty causing a delay of action or this inaction bias. Let me be a little bit more concrete what this strategy for policy evaluation and for actually specifying a policy cycle, what this is about. And here's my short reference to monetary policy, not with regard to ongoing monetary policy decisions, but when you think about what we've done and what we have achieved in monetary policy, there's been a long debate in academia, in practical policy making, on how we should be implementing monetary policy, what should be appropriate targets, how do we specify the policy cycle, and I would argue that we are on a very good track with regard to macroprudential policy in also defining what the goal of our policies is and how we should be implementing these goals, but we are certainly behind the discussion in monetary policies simply because this is such a new policy field and we still have to gather experience. So we need also for macroprudential policies, we need such a policy cycle and we need a well-defined set of criteria of what we are trying to achieve. And coming from academia, having done a lot of research also on banking, you may not be so surprised that the first bullet point of this, or the first item on my agenda for this policy cycle, is data. So why is data so crucial? Well, it's crucial because we need data for an ex-ante impact assessment, and we also need good data to assess whether once we've implemented a certain policy measure, whether it's actually reached its goal and achieved its target. And This is what we know from a lot of other policy areas. If we don't think about the data that are required early enough, then we might end up in the end with a situation where we can't really do a proper impact assessment because we haven't specified what we actually want to be looking at. I will be a little bit more concrete on this particular item a little bit later on when I talk about a specific policy measure that we're currently discussing in Germany. So data are crucial. We have to have the data ready, ready for use, and we need to make sure that those who want to do the impact assessment also have access to the data. And then, of course, as with any other policy that we want to implement, we need to define what is actually the target of our policies. And for monetary policy, we've defined targets in terms of the inflation rate that we should be aiming at. It's more difficult with regard to financial stability policies and macroprudential policies. So we certainly want to ensure sufficient resilience of the financial system. We want to ensure that there are no misaligned incentives that create distortions that lead to distortions that magnify credit cycles, but this is certainly more difficult to define and to specify than for other policy areas. But also in other policies, this is something we need to achieve, and there's maybe no consensus of what the best policy target is. Then we have to identify what's an appropriate intermediate target. Credit growth could be something, leverage of financial institutions could be an intermediate target, so maybe it's a little bit easier to identify these intermediate objectives, and we have them in our surveillance indicators for macroprudential policies already. The next step is to assign instruments to the objectives. So a couple of instruments have been mentioned already, capital requirements for banks, loan-to-value ratios, and we have to define how these policy instruments are related to the policy targets. And this is the task of an ex-ante policy evaluation. So in some sense or another, we are already doing this ex-ante policy evaluation. So even if we decide not to activate a certain instrument, we've taken a decision. And in some sense, we also have a model behind it that is guiding our decision. But I think in some cases, we have to become more concrete and define what is actually the model that we have behind our decision making, and how do we actually want to organize this ex-ante policy evaluation. And then comes the final step. It has already been mentioned that not that many macroprudential policy instruments have been implemented so far. So once we've done it, and once we had a certain time period in which we could observe what the effects of these policy instruments have been, then we can do a proper ex-ante impact assessment, again, based on the pre-specified policy objectives. So this is a very standardized set of indicators that we should go through. Let me come to a little bit more specific example of where we're currently trying in Germany. We're at the very first stage of this process, but we were trying to implement this. And this is the example of macroprudential instruments for the housing market. So the situation in Germany is such that we have lots of discussions, also public discussions, about potential bubbles building up on the housing market. So our analysis has always been very clear that we're saying, yes, we do see price increases in certain market segments. We do not see that this is a countrywide phenomenon that would cause us to worry in terms of financial stability, in particular because this is not credit finance to a large degree. So the volume of housing credit is not going up significantly. But still, we are looking at this. We're analyzing the situation. And we want to be ready to act in case that our assessment of the situation changes. Now, the problem is, if our assessment would change, we wouldn't have instruments, we wouldn't have the legal basis for implementing macroprudential instruments for the housing market in Germany, because we don't have, as has already been mentioned, this is under national responsibility, and we simply don't have the required legal background for this instrument. So this is why the German Financial Stability Council issued a recommendation to provide the legal basis for these instruments, and this is how it's related to the policy process and to the policy cycle, and to also make sure that we have sufficient data and the appropriate data for actually assessing these policy instruments, both ex ante and possibly ex post, because currently we don't have the necessary data available. We have information about housing loans, but we wouldn't have information on a consistent basis about LTV caps or the debt to income ratios, things that we would need for this measure. So the second part of this recommendation is providing the legal basis for these for the data that we would need, and also allow, if this would be implemented, also allow not only us as central banks or other authorities to perform the impact assessment, but also independent researchers, because I think we need a policy assessment also from that side. Just a very quick remark, and then I close on some work we are currently doing, trying to do exactly that kind of impact assessment. This is a very large research network that we have among central banks, in which we try to use the data that we have already, the data sets that we do have, information about macroprudential policies that have been implemented around the world, and to try and do an assessment of the cross-border effects of macroprudential policies. This work is very much ongoing, so I don't want to go into the very details. But what we do see is that if you want to do a proper impact assessment, first of all, you need the data. We collected new data in collaboration with the International Monetary Fund and also with a lot of central banks. The data will also be online, hosted by the Fed board, so that everybody can use it. And we found that there's a lot of heterogeneity in this data set. So if we want to understand what the impact is of macroprudential policies on individual institutions, what are the cross-border effects, we need data at the micro level in order to do a proper impact assessment, because the experience differs a lot across countries. So summing up, because one of the tasks is to talk about the complex European framework and where are we in balancing national responsibilities and European responsibilities. So the first point I wanted to make here is that we do need, for macroprudential policies, we need a policy cycle as we do have it for monetary policy. We are working on this on a lot of fronts in a lot of committees, so I'm not saying that we haven't acknowledged this, but I think it's important to make us aware of it. For policy evaluation, for this policy cycle, we need data. We also need the legal mandates to do the policy evaluation. And that is something we also need in the national laws. But at the same time, we need this coordination mechanism that has been described very well by the first speaker, through the international institutions, through the international bodies. We need peer reviews. We need also some kind of best practice in terms of policy assessment, implementation of these policies. And I think this is a very useful area where the European and also the international level comes in. I leave it at that because we'll have more time to discuss, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Claudia. Very interesting, and I think especially your last point on cross-border and on LTV, which is national, there we really can have later on the discussion, is it okay for all countries to do their own thing, or do we need some consistency and coordinated approach? But so far, You haven't seen worried central bankers. So in the euro area, asset price bubbles are not yet on the radar. But now, if we move to Sweden, there it is on the radar already for quite a while. I'm really looking forward, Cecilia, to your in the hot seat, as to say, how to reconcile macroprudential and monetary policy in practice.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for the invitation. Sweden is an out country, both in terms of the euro area and also the banking union, it's a great privilege to come here and explain to you how, which is the focus of my first intervention, two topics. First one is describing the organization and the governance of the macroprudential policy in Sweden, and I would like you also to walk you through a very hands-on example of how a macroprudential tool is being implemented in Sweden right now. And my second topic is giving you some comments on the question of relationship between macroprudential policy and monetary policy And this is based on Swedish experiences from recent years, which has been come out in the public debate as rather interesting. In Sweden, like many other countries, we didn't have any macroprudential authority identified until 2 years ago, but in 2013, the Swedish government appointed the Financial Supervisory Authority, the FSA, to be responsible for macroprudential policy and tools. At the same time, also a Financial Stability Council was formed, and this consists of the FSA, the Riksbank, the Minister of Finance, and also the Swedish National Debt Office, which is appointed as the Resolution Committee in Resolution Authority in Sweden. This new Stability Council meets sort of biannually, they are not competent to make decisions on macroprudential policy, or they not have any powers to give recommendations. So it is the FSA who are running the macroprudential policy and has responsibilities for tools. This council is also chaired by the Cabinet Minister for Financial Markets. And the fact that there is the FSA, that is the macroprudential authority, and that the Stability Council only is a forum for discussions and no decision-makings, make the Swedish institutional framework differ somewhat from any other Euro countries. For example, my own Riksbank, the central bank, the formal role for us when it comes to macroprudential policy is much more limited in Sweden than in most EU countries. As you know, EU central banks are usually in some way formally involved in the policy making, for example, by setting counter-cyclical buffer or chairing the policy board or policy council in macroprudential policy. And looking at the EU institutional level, the Swedish setup also contrasts somewhat when it comes to the voting power given to central banks in the ESRB and the topping up abilities provided by to the ECB in the banking union. Looking at what has happened in Sweden over recent years, we have a quite a rapid increase in household debts. The FSA has introduced some measures to strengthen banking resilience and tame the financial cycle. Prominent examples here being an LTV ceiling of 85% on new loans, which was introduced in 2010 already. The counter-cyclical buffer rate is set at 1.5%, and there's also floors on risk weights on mortgage loans that has been set to 25%, and this has been within the Pillar 2 framework in the micro-surveillance. However, one tricky question, a key aspect of the macroprudential framework in the future, and which Sweden is struggling with at the moment, is the formulation of the mandate. The FSA's mandate, what are they supposed to do and what kind of tools, legal tools, do they have at their disposal has been very much discussed in Sweden in recent years. We know that the purpose of macroprudential policy is to mitigate risks in the financial system, but the question is, how efficient are the Swedish policy framework in this respect? It's a bit too early to say, but we have an interesting example of that the FSA's mandate to take actions is sort of limited unless there is an immediate threat to financial stability. And this became evident last year when the FSA proposed compulsory amortization schedule in order to curb household debt development. FSA argue the classical arguments that unbalanced development in the credit market could cause volatility in the economy, possibly leading to a large economic downturn. And an amortization requirement would decrease these risks. But when this policy was put into consultation, several consultation respondents on the legal side criticized the suggestion from the FSA, saying that they basically didn't have the legal support to take this kind of decision. So the FSA withdrew the proposal of compulsory amortization in Sweden. And they have also meant that the lack of clarity in the mandate has meant that FSA has sort of put further macro prudential tools on hold. Recently, the Swedish government has introduced a proposal to legislate on this amortization requirement, and it's expected that this law will be put into place later this year. But as you may understand, it has been a considerable delay of more than a year before these amortization requirement provisions are in place. This may be a domestic problem only managed by the Swedes, but it may also be interesting to see in the years to come if more countries facing the same kind of problems when it comes to the governance and the framework of this. My second topic is the relationship between macroprudential policy and monetary policy. And here you may have heard that sometimes Sweden is used as an illustration that monetary policy should not lean against the wind. And the story goes something like this. After the crisis, the Riksbank conducted a policy experiment where it went sort of all in to use policy rate to prevent household debt from increasing, and this completely ignored the development in inflation and real economy. And as a result of this policy experiment, the inflation fell to zero and the economy plunged, and this proves that policy rates should not be used to lean against the wind. This kind of description is a bit unfair. I think it also may risk leading the wrong conclusions in the international debate on whether monetary policy could be used, should be used, may be used to support macroprudential policy when we are struggling to prevent build-up in financial imbalances. What happened in Sweden was that leaning, I would say, played a marginal role for the rate hikes that took place in 2010 and 2011. If you look at the Riksbank minutes from the time, that is clear. If you look also at arguments from other forecasters at the time, it is also clear that there were conventional arguments for the monetary policy tightening at the time. The National Institute of Economic Research, which is one of Sweden's leading forecasters, expected and recommended that policy rates should continue to rise over the years 2011 to 2012 and 2013, and that this policy was considered to be compatible with a balanced resource utilization in the years to come, and that inflation rate would be in line with target of 2% in the years of sort of 13 to 15. So it's clear that monetary policy was sort of regarded as being predominantly governed by traditional motives. There was a cyclical upturn at the time that was strong, and that the concern of household debts did not play a particularly major role at the time. However, from end 2011 and onwards, I think it's probably to say in hindsight that there was probably a larger element of leaning when policy rates began to be reduced in 11 and onwards, because also Swedish economy was hit by the euro crisis. I personally was not on the board until mid-2013, but I believe that if the Riksbank had been less worried about the development in household debt and house prices, the cutting phase would probably have become a bit faster. But I think it's a matter of degrees. I think we're talking about months rather than quarters of years. The Riksbank was overestimating inflation at the time, but we were not the only ones to do this, and seen in the light of international developments, it appears that many countries have overestimated inflation. So what are the lessons that I make from the Swedish experience? Well, there are two main takeaways. I think it's probably difficult to use the policy rate to lean heavily against the wind when you look at it in practical terms. Policy rate cannot be targeted specifically at build-up of financial imbalances, since it has a more broad impact of economy. And the short-run costs of using policy rate is visible and tangible, but the long-run benefits are more uncertain and abstract. So I think it's no surprise that we haven't seen any central bank that has used the interest rate to curb financial imbalances to any great extent. The second learning I do from this is it's important to always keep your eye on the inflation. In the years after the crisis, the global financial crisis, the Riksbank communicated a lot about the worries about the increasing household debt and housing prices. And I think this created a lot of much needed attention to the problem. There is now, I would say, broad consensus among most Swedish economists that this is not a sustainable development. However, this also probably, since it coincided within a period when inflation decreased, this probably also contributed to the fall in inflation expectations. Some of the criticism against the Riksbank was that Riksbank was focusing too much on household and not enough on inflation, and that would not long be important. And that had perhaps blurred the confidence in the inflation targeting framework that Riksbank has been working with for 20 years. So to summarize, well-anchored inflation expectations are, as always, a prerequisite for taking other considerations into account in monetary policy besides inflation targeting. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Cecilia. And I think you've learned us one thing, and that this link is extremely difficult in practice, because we can have lots of theories about it, and in each situation is also different. But then, before opening the floor, I want to ask two questions to the panel. All of you have talked about loan-to-value, and you talked in addition about amortization. And Europe is plagued by really a lack of clear legislation. So many countries, including my own, there is no. I'm from the Netherlands. There is no clear legal basis. So sometimes it is a bit of self-regulation. Sometimes there are instruments. In Germany, you're recommending it. And it is clearly in the national domain. And in addition, it's extremely political, because housing is political. You have to say to young couples, you have to wait for 2 years before you can buy a house. Who's going to do that? So it is extremely difficult. While on the banking side, with the countercyclical capital buffer, we have implemented that in the Capital Requirements Directive. So that's now European, and the ESB and the ECB have some role. That's all in place. My question to the panel would be, A, do we need a strong legal basis, and in addition, Cecilia, to be a bit broad-based mandate, so not only the LTV itself, but more whatever you do with mortgage credit. But B, do we need to have some kind of European approach? Because as Claudia said, we have these cross-border banks. So can we really, and if you have different definitions in countries, how can the ECB do their work? So do we need legislation? And two, should it be national, or should we have an European approach? Can I start with you, Ignacio?
This was question one. Question two?
You said these coming later on.
All right. The loan-to-value ratio is not a European instrument, as it was... as it was mentioned, it's a very delicate one. I would think that, at least for the time being, perhaps it's a good thing that it's not in the European domain, because precisely because of the extreme complication, political and technical and the institutional, legal, etc., of activating these particular instruments. The basket of things to be done and to work on is already sufficiently large that, and the number of instruments, I mean, if you count them, we count the macroprudential instrument by the dozen. So adding additional instrument perhaps at the margin is not... The counter-cyclical capital buffer is a substitute. What we observe now on the counter-cyclical capital buffers is that all countries have introduced it, but with a coefficient of zero. So it's a little bit of a, I don't know how you want to call it, but this is an instrument, non-instruments. Of course, the reason is that we started from a situation not of boom, but the opposite of bust, or at least cyclical weakness. So authorities have the intention perhaps of using it in the future, but not yet, except for the UK. The UK has announced recently that they are going to use the countercyclical capital buffer soon. So that would be my take on the loan to value.
Yeah, first of all, on in terms of what are these instruments, so the countercyclical capital buffer and LTV caps or debt service to income ratio, so there's a whole bundle. If you've looked at my list, there's actually four instruments we're recommending to have. I think they target different sides of the market. So the countercyclical capital buffer is more on the supply side, the side of the banks, whereas the LTV amortization requirements, all that is about the contract term. So it's also looking at the demand side. So that's certainly something that is to be distinguished, and there might be circumstances where you want to be more specific and target a certain market segment where the countercyclical capital buffer is pretty broad. I know that some countries have also applied it to the real estate market, but I'm not familiar with their legal circumstances. Maybe they would have liked to do something else, but they had the countercyclical capital buffer in place, so that's why they used it. So in that sense, do we need a stronger legal basis and a broader mandate in terms of having these macroprudential instruments targeted at certain sectors, in particular the real estate sectors? The answer is a clear yes. So this is why we issued this recommendation. And do we need it at the European level? I would also be a little bit more cautious because we have all these discussions at the national level. The housing market may be very specific to a certain country. So I would be happy if we had sufficient legal frameworks at the national level, while at the same time, of course, we need a strong international European framework for this. So we need peer reviews, we need discussions about what's going on national real estate markets at the European level, because we know there's spillovers. We may need reciprocity for these measures if there's strong linkages between countries. So all that, yes, whether we need to coordinate on a specific instrument that we want to have at the European level. I mean, this is also a discussion which is ongoing, and I'm a little bit torn because there's pros and cons. Maybe one short side remark on the notifications and the countercyclical capital buffer. I think everybody wouldn't be really sad if we would do it less frequently than at a quarterly time horizon. So we do this very, very frequently, this notification process. I think this is also one of the discussions we're going to have, whether the process could be streamlined. But this is actually part of the learning process that I was talking about. So when I'm talking about policy evaluation, this is also about learning from our experiences. And if we find that we do quarterly notifications for zero capital buffers, maybe then we have to revise the strategy a bit. But this is not saying that we've done anything wrong, but it's just saying that we've learned from the process.
Well, this, I think the Swedish experience has been is that once the genie is out of the bottle when it comes to LTVs and amortization, it's really hard to put the back in terms of putting in LTV ceilings and amortization, compulsory amortization. It's hard work introducing them because, as you said, there is someone who's going to feel the pinch from it. So I think once you have managed to introduce them, I think you should avoid moving them around too much and see some of these macroprudential tools. Now we're talking about LTV and amortization as a time variant measure. When it comes to a countercyclical buffer, I would say that the Swedish process has worked fairly well. The FSA used the credit gap indicator framework. We have different views on the Riksbank and the FSA have different views on the appropriate level, but it's at least a decision process that works well. And I have maybe a question back to the INS countries of whether the sort of the European approach and the national and the international perspective. Would it be possible for the ECB to make the suggestions on the countercyclical buffer and then government, national and national basis could either complain or comply or explain to an ECB suggestion? Would that be possible?
Return what is in the SSM regulation.
So this happens in the context of the SRB. There is recommendations and there is a comply or explain. The SSM can do more. The SSM can act in principle. It hasn't done that yet, but in principle can act by increasing the coefficient. Now all coefficients are zero, so there is potentially plenty of room for increasing, but it's not happening.
And then we go to the floor. Ignacio mentioned this issue of that you can do local credit policies by macroprudential. And I saw on your slide, Claudia, credit growth as one of the intermediate objectives. And I think rightly so, whether it's credit growth or leverage, it is basically aiming the same. If we think in a Minsky world, where if credit is growing too fast, then you need to act. And then I start with you, Claudia. How do you see that? Do you think it is useful to have that in addition to a single monetary policy? And do you see the danger that it can be conflict, or is it just strengthening? So is it good to have this instrument at the local level? And how would you apply it?
I'm not sure whether I get the question right. So is this a question about, because credit growth could also be an intermediate indicator for monetary policy. That's your question. Yeah. So you could have the same intermediate indicator being an indicator both for macro-pru and monetary policy. If we take this question to a broader context, so what is the exact interaction between macroprudential policies and monetary policy? Of course, this is a very, as has been mentioned now by previous speakers, there's a very complex interrelationship, and I wouldn't argue that you should have one indicator to assess the stance of macroprudential policy and maybe the same or very similar indicator to assess the stance of monetary policy. I think for macroprudential policy, what we've learned is that there's actually a number of indicators we have to look at, and it's maybe not even sufficient to just look at aggregate credit growth. So you might have a situation where risk in the financial system is building up, which you don't see in the aggregate, but you need a finer breakdown. So maybe monetary policymakers would argue the same way, that you can't just look at a single indicator. But I think this is one clear distinction where, yes, the indicators might sound similar, but it's actually different policy targets that you have, and policy and different links between or transmission channels between these indicators and the ultimate policy target. But this is clearly a discussion we have to have. So there's yet another layer of the discussion: should we be changing our policy rules? But I think we are far from answering that question. We first have to understand what is the transmission between the targets of macroprudential policy and monetary policy. How is this linked to the intermediate targets? And this is exactly where we do need more analysis. Without saying that more analysis means that we should wait until we implement anything.
Open to the floor. Any questions? So let me just note Kuntram from the back, Lisa. Kuntram, do you want to start?
Yeah, I want to start, I think, with a simple question. In the earlier times, I'm not sure whether that's still the case, actually, the ECB had two pillars for monetary policy. The first pillar...
You still do,
okay. So you had the monetary pillar, which looked sort of at the monetary aggregates, and the other one, which looked at everything else. Of course, if you look at the monetary pillar, what is it? Well, it's basically the development of monetary aggregates, and the development of monetary aggregates is, to a large extent, driven by credit developments, because, you know, the counterpart to money is credit. And so you know, what I fail to understand is really here the place of macroprudential policy. I mean, if we believe this is a central element for central banking, the monetary pillar, so for monetary policy, then supposedly whatever monetary policy does has some direct consequences on this. And so, is then the role of macroprudential policy? Is there still a Eurozone role for macroprudential policy, or should macroprudential policy become really a national instrument to sort of steer the national cycles a bit more, given that we only have one common monetary policy, but we still want to have some national instrument? Is that something that we should be thinking of in terms of Eurozone macroprudential policy, or in what direction should we conceptually think about this macroprudential policy?
Thanks. No, I enjoyed all the remarks of the panel, and I think we heard all the difficulties of implementing this, of even having a framework. As Claudia said, you know, we don't have a clear framework, a theoretical framework, leave alone then obviously a clear framework for the implementation. Nonetheless, I want to talk a little bit the opposite way that the, some of the messages that, that I heard. I mean, it seems to me that the great value of macroprudential a state of mind. So yes, it is obviously the same instruments as microprudential policy, Ignacio. I mean, that is to some extent that is right. But I think to me the main value of macroprudential policy is a framework for thinking about matters. Then one can discuss how to implement it. And I think all of this, you know, I think all of this is well taken. But I slightly worry that some of the messages would sort of take us back to the pre-crisis situation. That I think would be a mistake. And you know, while accepting very well all the points that were made, I think very valid points, as I say, both on the framework and on the instruments, I do think that there is a great value in thinking in a macro in a macro sense. It makes me think a little. I was rereading a book on Keynes, a very nice book by Peter Temin and David Vines. On Keynes. It sort of made me think exactly of the same discussion. You know, when Keynes came about, he introduced macroeconomics. And so there is something more than the working of individual markets for the macroeconomy. I think there is, in the same manner, there is something beyond for financial stability than the financial stability of each individual institution of the macro, of the micro one. And I think, to me, that is the main that is the main message. Now, then we have to take that message forward and be modest into how we can implement it. But I think what we should not be modest about is about the need to have that that frame, that mindset when we come to reflecting. So, you know, while that's my message, while I accept everything that you have said, everything, I think, I still want to say, let's not stop there. Let's say that we are in a different mindset now, and that with modesty, we want to be able to have this macro approach that still needs to be, obviously, much perfected.
Now I go back to the panel, and Claudio Borio would say that to look at prudential policies with the macro lens. That's exactly what you're saying. Can I start with you, Cecilia, on the first question, because you are in Sweden, and how do you deal with these two pillars? So on the one side, the monetary aggregates, you look also at credit growth, but and the difference between macroprudential, what is your experience?
Well, we're looking at the monetary indicators, they haven't been very useful to us for a very, very long time, to be really frank. But what they do tell us at the moment is obviously what we are conducting at the moment, which is that the monetary policy in Sweden is extremely stimulative. But if we would start to react on these very expansionary monetary indicators, we would have to go back to the problem we were sitting in a couple of years ago, which was that we were both concerned about inflation, as we still are, but also on the credit expansion. And we don't want to fail both objectives. Looking at our core task, it is price stability, inflation targeting framework. And the choice between two difficult things, too low inflation or too high credit growth, we choose to fight the low inflation. and acknowledge the fact that the macro prudential responsibility is not in our hands, but in the FSA's hands. And then we try to be as good as we can on providing both the FSA and the general opinion in Sweden, the common people, the common sort of the public, our research on these matters. But we are not the ones who push the buttons.
Claudia, you're working at the central bank, which has some monetary aggregates in the past, always seen as extremely important. What is your experience? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I certainly wouldn't think that this is the right moment to start discussing the overall strategy of the ECB, and I think that also wasn't your point. I think your point was more about where should macroprudential policy be? Should it be at the national level? Should it be at the European level? So as I said earlier, I don't think it would be the time to discuss general policy mandates or strategies, and I think there are many reasons to have this national responsibility, some of which we've heard. So for the time being, we don't have, for certain instruments, we don't have them at the European level. So if we think about the need and the possibility to act, it has to be national. The costs of financial crisis are to a large extent national, so that's also a reason to have it to have it national. And financial systems are very different. This is, I think, also the point that I would answer to the question about the comparison to the U.S. So some of the discussions we hear in the U.S. about appropriate macroprudential policy instruments are really driven by the fact that the financial system is very, very different. And so this is also why you need different policy instruments. At the same time, we need this international coordination. It's very good. I mean, sometimes these meetings are huge, and you wonder about the efficiency of having, 80 people sitting around the table. But at the same time, you bring people to the same table and talk about the same issues in the same type of framework. And here, this is actually the most important point I took from the discussion, the point André made about communication, about talking about what we are doing. This is really crucial. So in terms of the instruments, we were talking about the hard instruments. And I think this whole communication about what is macroprudential policy, what is it that we try to achieve, which is different from, in terms of the policy goals, the instruments, from monetary policy, from microprudential policy, I think that communication is very important. And I think the countries that are here around the table who have actually activated macroprudential policy instruments probably know much better what I'm talking about than I could, because they've made this experience that if you all of a sudden come up and you say, well, we need to activate this instrument for macroprudential policy reasons, and the public has never discussed what is macroprudential policy, then of course you have a very hard time. So you also need to have a sense of what is it that we're trying to achieve, and this is what this, apart from the hard coordination mechanisms and reciprocity and all that, this is also something that the international fora achieve, that we do have a common communication about what is macroprudential policy and what do we need to achieve.
Ignacio, could you also take both questions, both on the monetary and on the international?
Let me start with André's reference to the state of mind, which I enjoyed tremendously. I couldn't agree more that what we need is to expand our state of mind and to encompass new thing. But think of this, try to put two people with two different states of mind in the same room and they have to decide on the same instrument. I think you will see the complexities that I refer to in the... So we certainly need to take these new dimensions of policy into account. The question is whether you do it this by educating the existing macroprudential authorities or... to some extent, the framework is there. So we have national designated authorities and national competent, as they called it, not that the others are incompetent, but competent authorities to decide on two different things, both at the national and at the European level. So we have to work with that framework now. But what I would advocate in that context is an effective integration, liaison, communication, dialogue between these two, because otherwise it's going to be very complicated. Now, on the U.S., my understanding, and this comes largely by reading the latest issue of the report, the latest report of the Office of Financial Research, which is the U.S. equivalent of the ESRB, that basically they concluded that those complexities prevent now the US from using macroprudential instruments to a significant extent in the foreseeable future. I'm aware that they have done a simulation exercise that they called, I think they called it a tabletop exercise in the US, whereby they put five or six local Fed presidents in the room, they gave them a scenario, a hypothetical scenario, and they asked these policymakers, what instrument would you use? And apparently none of them came up saying, I would use the macroprudential instruments. You know, they also, as a result of those internal reflections within the Federal Reserve System, I think that's the conclusion for the moment. On concerning M3, I will reflect more about it and come back to you.
Yes, I have a question on other part of the financing than bank credit, because I have in mind that an important aspect of macro pru is also to encompass other source of financing, and the case of France is actually particularly interesting because there is an important development of market-based financing for the non-financial corporate sector. So my question is, you only mention bank-related macroprud instrument. How would you encompass this new disintermediation process in this framework?
Extremely relevant question.
I have a few questions. Well, one is related to what Guttram has mentioned about a sort of a European financial cycle. Presumably there is a European financial cycle, because if we look at credit dynamics in the pre-crisis years, there is tremendous, there are tremendous similarities among a bunch of countries inside the euro area and countries outside the euro area, and the inability of national authorities to stem the flow of credit. So I think there is a European financial cycle, and there is a European financial cycle at work. It may not be working now, but then what about national prerogatives as against European level prerogatives? Secondly, I'm asking the panelists, I'm asking myself, as a matter of fact, we have been inept for years, for a long period of time, in dealing with the flow of credit, and probably there was also the lack of understanding of financial stability as against price stability. But I'm asking myself, if we are to live for a long period of time with very low interest rates, which according to the BIS view is very distorting, and one has to deal with it. I mean, so how should one formulate? Because if this is very bad for resource misallocation, and we are going to live for years with very low interest rates, so what should macroprudential policies in relation with monetary policies do? Third, what about the culture of banking? Is culture of banking a concern for macroprudential policy? Because if the culture of banking is so bad for financial stability, then macroprudential policy also, macroprudential policy seems to be very much focused right now only on credit controls. It's a euphemism. Instead of saying credit controls and interfering with markets, we say macroprudential policies. And finally, I think it's about inflation targeting. And here I come, it's because inflation targeting seems also to have been quite, I'm not saying inept, but blind to credit dynamics and the formation of bubbles. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, in fact, I have a specific question for Mrs. Boer. You rightly stress that macroprudential policy is characterized by a high degree of uncertainty. The framework maybe is not yet completely specified. There is no appropriate legal basis and there are lack of data. But I am convinced that there is already a lot of work being done on that matter, and especially by the ESRB. And I will mention some main work of the ESRB. First of all, you have the recommendation of the ESRB on the legal mandate. And every country has to design a national competent authority that should be in place in every member state. So that recommendation, of course, is not fulfilled in every country in the most ideal way, but I think it's a good base to have a start for a legal base for macroprudential policy. Secondly, the ESRB has also done a huge work, a very huge handbook on macroprudential instruments, where they describe the instruments, the framework, the data needed, and so on and so on. On very specific issues, the ESRB also has worked on data on mortgage items. They worked on international issues, which measures of macroprudential policy does need reciprocation. So there is a lot of framework put in place. So my question is, do you think that the work by the ESRB is insufficient? Does it not need to be improved? Because when I heard your exposé, you give the impression that macroprudential policy is still in the beginning of its implementation and its design, but that's not true. I think a lot of things have been done already. Thank you.
So we have three questions. Then I come to a last round. What should we do about disintermediation, so non-bank, shadow banking, European financial cycle, and in the end, is macroprudential not the old-fashioned credit controls? And finally, is the ECB already doing enough on data? So I start with Claudia.
Yeah, thank you very much for giving me the chance to clarify this. So I could have done the same presentation telling you what we have done and what we have achieved. But I think Bruegel is always a bit forward-looking and wants to look at the challenges for the future. So, I mean, this is a new policy field, and we have to be aware of the fact that we've done there's actually good work. Markus Brunnermeier and Isabel Schnabel have written a very nice paper where they look at prudential measures that had macroprudential effects that in nowadays we would actually call macroprudential measures, and what the impact has been on the cycle. So it's all not that new, but in terms of defining these policies, setting up institutions, both at the international and at the national level, having instruments that are designated as macroprudential policy instruments. In that sense, it is a new field. And of course, a new field is emerging. The world around us is emerging, and we also have to act on certain fronts. But I just wanted to make us all aware of the fact that there's also still a lot of work to be done in terms of the conceptual work, in terms of and testing what we have done. Are we on the right track? So this was more my line of intervention, not to say that the ESRB has not done enough or the national. So I would apologize to all financial stability councils who feel offended that I would have said that they're not doing enough. So we're doing a lot of things, and actually the ESRB is also a good role model for what I've mentioned in terms of having this a very strong role of a scientific advisory board, because that I think has also played an important role in terms of stimulating policy debates, but we're certainly behind other policy areas where we have much more experience over the past decades in terms of defining the framework in which we are working. Maybe just one quick word on this other forms of financing. I think this is you're touching on an important issue, because in some sense I think we've in dealing with the crisis and learning from the crisis and setting up all these institutions, I think we've not sufficiently paid attention to the development of equity markets and equity finance. I think that in that sense the Capital Markets Union is a very important project, because it's also reminding us that there are other market segments that are also important that have financial stability implications. Maybe, I mean, this is completely counterfactual. Had we had more equity finance, cross-border equity finance, maybe the entire financial system would have been more resilient to shocks. So I think in that sense that there's even more that needs to be done than this narrow set of macroprudential instruments. And of course, then we also have to think about as we develop other markets further, or rather lift constraints to the efficient functioning of these markets, are there other risks building up, and do we maybe need additional instruments also in dealing with these risks? I think this is also a debate that we should have, in particular when it comes to shadow banking. You know, all know that there's a lot of activity in terms of monitoring and also thinking about the potential risks and how we should be dealing with them.
To pick up the same subject, how to use macroprudential tools in a more sort of world with more market financing, or should it be used? Should macroprudential tools be used in the non-bank world? Well, that is the question of how big scope you should set for macroprudential policy. Should it only be about bank resilience, or should it have higher ambitions, broader ambitions than that? And my view, and I'm struggling a lot with this question, is that I think macroprudential should focus on bank resilience and the credit cycles where it involves the households, because we know from history that when households get it wrong, the problems for the whole economy becomes severe compared to when companies get it wrong. So I'm all for a larger bond market. I think I agree with Claudia that if we have alternative sources of financing, that is okay. And if, as long as the owners of this increased bond holding are investors rather than households and banks, I don't see a desperate need to include macroprudential tools in market financing. I liked the state of mind thought from Andre, is that right? I'm kind of trying to go back to history here. Inflation targeting was about forcing wage and price setters into a framework of stabilizing inflation, and that took some time, but we are now fairly successful in the world. Now policymakers are addressing excessive behavior in the capital markets instead. And I think the state of mind framework is a good starting point, but I think addressing excessive behavior in the capital market is also about showing strong commitment by competent and powerful authorities in introducing measures. Because at the end of the day, I hope that the best macroprudential policy will be the ones that you don't have to apply, because it's the responsibilities and the behavior in the capital markets will be prudent. That's a starting point. But that is an ideal view that I have sort of long term. Stop.
It's, but Ignacio, do you have to say
banking? Very minor. I think the remark is well placed. It's a very important one. That's one of the reasons, by the way, the proponents of leaning against the wind argue exactly that. The monetary policy can reach all the ramifications of the financial sector, as opposed to instruments which are applied on banks, not only act only on banks, but may induce migration from the banks to the rest of the financial sector. So that is something that people are worried about, and they've not found yet a solution. The ESRB, I agree, the ESRB, and I note that they've done an immense amount of work in the recent years, also supported by a very powerful set of academics in the scientific committee. But so we have manuals of instruments, we have a wealth of data, et cetera, coming from the ESRB, large part of which is public, and that's another good thing. So this is increasing the culture of people on these issues. I would say that even the ESRB has not yet fully solved the complication arising from multiple instruments, multiple actors, particularly in the European context, and the difficulties, I would say, of defining and measuring the goal.
And on this transparency, the latest report from the ESRB is very much in line with what we discussed today, is on the real estate markets, both residential and commercial real estate. So I can encourage you to read that, a lot of data in that. Final round of questions.
Yeah, my
if I may add to that problem, like you don't have legal appeals against an interest rate rise or decrease. Well, on the microprudential side, all the statutory instruments, there are many appeals by the institutions. So that makes it, that is increasing your problem.
No, I think it's very right, Francesco, what you said, but this applies to prudential policy in general, including micro, right? The micro even more imposes behavior on individuals. That requires, by the way, that was true also for the old-fashioned and old-time credit controls that we are familiar with and from our youth. They also impose behavior of an individual and were stemming from the central bank. I think this requires two set of legal bases, requires two set of maybe statutes, as we have, and for sure, two different sets of lawyers to enforce that.
A short comment on this. Is it a problem to give central bank macroprudential powers? Well, one way to solve that problem, if it is considered to be a big problem, is to let the central bank be the ones who suggest and introduce macroprudential tools, but pass it through a kind of council there where also other voices are represented, such as the government or the resolution authority or other competent authorities. That gives at least the process a transparency, which I think is key to the confidence and also more of a democratic legitimacy. So I think that the problem can be worked around.
One question that I had wanted to ask before is the division between structural and cyclical macroprudential policy. Maybe there is a bit too much of emphasis, for my taste, on the cyclical, on the counter-cyclical, I mean, whatever you want to call it, counter-cyclical. Macroprudential policy. I mean, my feeling or my hunch, since we should only talk of hunches in this domain, my hunch is that the structural is more important than the cyclical, or will prove to be, with time, will prove to be more important. That is not so much sort of the fine-tuning macroprudential policy, the counter-cyclical buffers and, all of those kind of things. And that indeed does link to the monetary policy. But it seems to me that with time, it's probably the structural measures, those that are not, Claudia, you made the reference, which I would agree, it's the LTV, the stable LTV, rather than sort of, trying to move it around the cycle. I think that is going to be potentially proving very, very important. And I think there are other macroprudential policy. I mean, one of the issues that we had been discussing when we were all together in the Advisory Scientific Council Committee was also the exposure, the sovereign exposure. I mean, that's also a macroprudential policy, right? To reduce exposure of the financial sector, not just of banks, insurance sectors as well, to sovereign debt, and in particular to national, to own sovereign debt. I mean, those kind of things are macroprudential, but not maybe of what many people imagine the macroprudential to be if you think of this cyclical and or anti-cyclical policy. So that was my second point, sort of, should we not reflect more on macroprudential on the structural side rather than on the cyclical, as it has often been the case?
No, I couldn't agree more. I mean, in the end, it's an empirical question, and it depends also on how good we are in terms of measuring the cycle and all that. But no, I couldn't agree more in the sense that this is also what we look at. It's first of all the resilience of the system, the capital in the system, and that's also if you want a structural feature of financial systems, how well capitalized they are. And the second is what I briefly mentioned, incentives. So we don't want misaligned incentives in the system that magnify cycles. So cycles we're always going to have, but it's easy to write up a theoretical model where you have some distortion in the system that serves to magnify the cycle that we have. And then of course it would be the superior policy to remove the friction and to remove the disincentive. I fully agree that it's really about thinking about the resilience of the entire system, so that we don't get these situations where a relatively small shock is affecting the aggregate. I mean, this is mainly what we're talking about.
I agree with André. The structural component should be important, prominent. In principle, the macro-pru instruments are all structural, because even the counter-cyclical capital buffer is rule-based. It's not supposed to be changed every quarter, so it's structural there as well. There is a little bit of a conflict with the quarterly notification, because if it is structural, why do you have to notify quarterly? What I think it would be interesting to look into in this regard is the recent decisions on the so-called OSI buffers. The national designated authorities have recently notified both the list of banks that they consider are the significant institutions at the national level, and also the surcharges that they apply to each of them. Some of those surcharges are quite significant, quite strong. Some others are relatively low, perhaps some of them quite surprisingly low. Others are kind of average. So I think it would be interesting to look into those decisions and their determinants.
Okay, thank you. We are exactly in time, and leaving 1 minute for me to conclude. I think Gregory chose the title for this session, Complexity. I think we've lived up to that. Not only the setup, but also many instruments. The next thing we have learned, that the real life of macroprudential can be messy, as we've seen in Sweden. So it is very difficult, many actors, you need legislation. And then that comes to my final point, that you may be too late, because I think the status quo is always strong. To activating it is sometimes difficult. So that will be quite a challenge. So in the euro area, other than Sweden and UK, we don't see yet many of the asset price bubbles coming up. But if they come up, my big question is, would we really be ready to activate the instruments in time? I think that's extremely important. And reminding what I said in the introduction, the dot-com bubble had the loose monetary policy afterwards, was sowing the seeds for the bubble afterwards. So we have to be very careful, and that's exactly what the BIS is warning of. But then what we all have to do is to become, like André said, macro in state of mind, so we need to be alert to that. And please join me in thanking the panel for really excellent contributions.